Today's project is this book, which measures about 6 inches by 6 inches and is made from one of Tim Holtz's grunge books, as well as the lovely nesting ground papers from Catherine Moore. In the video, I'll show you how to paper the pages and then embellish them with all manner of pretty things. We'll create the book from cover to cover, and I know you'll love yours as much as I do mine. The two main elements to our project are the grunge book made by Tim Holtz under the Ideology line and Catherine Moore's Nesting Grounds paper pack, which contains 10 different pattern pieces of paper. This is the grunge book. It's made of grunge board that's been pre-punched. It measures 5 7/8 inches tall by 6 inches wide. There are 12 of the pages and there are 2 of these binding rings. These are some samples of pages that I've already begun, and when you add the paper to the pages, you have a couple of options. You can either do what I've done here, which is to use one piece of paper, and it's the entire background of the page, or you can piece various elements in the way that I've done on these other pages. And you'll notice that some of them don't actually have any of the nesting ground papers. They're just a combination of, in this case, watercolor paper that I stained with distress stain and some dictionary paper. We're going to start with the most straightforward option, which is to use one piece of paper as our background. But you'll notice as we go along that I save everything. All of these little bits, these are going to come in handy later as we piece together various elements to cover that grunge board. So save everything. The littlest bit is probably going to come in handy at some point. I have one piece from the set, and I've already trimmed one side because I know that I want this to sit on this page about like this. I know I want the bottom edge of this lace on the bottom edge of my page, and then however much of this design comes forward. So what I've done in preparation is I've put score tape on the back of this page. The holes are over here, so this would be the top of the page as it faces you. Because this page is not quite 6 inches tall, it means that I'm going to have to do some trimming, and I would have to do that anyway. But what I've done is laid the score tape across here. I have a 2.5, a 2.5, and then a 1. And you can see that I've already trimmed 2 of the sides, and I'm going to come in and I'm going to trim the other 2, and it's pretty straightforward. Now I will tell you that when I trim like this, I don't use my rotary cutter. I find that using a utility knife is a much better option. It allows me to trim without getting into trouble, and by that I mean when I use a rotary cutter on here, I find, especially in little narrow sections, that the adhesive rolls off that paper backing and it starts to get tangled up in the blade of the rotary cutter, and that's just a recipe for disaster. You don't want to have to deal with that. So all I'm going to do is line my ruler up with the edge of the grunge board, and I can tell you from experience that you can't use the grunge board alone to use as an edge guide for your utility knife. You will cut right through the grunge board. Been there, done that. All right, so now I'm going to just trim this other side. Okay, put this to one side. And you can see now that I have my page ready to go. Now once I get the paper, the nesting grounds paper, attached to this side, what I will do is come back with my hole punch and I'm going to punch these out. I don't want to lose track of where these holes are, and if I forget to punch once I put the paper on and then I do the same thing over here, I'm going to be left poking around trying to find where they are. So I'm going to turn this to face me and then I'm going to start removing the backing on this. And you have to make certain that your score tape is actually burnished on here, or starting to peel that protective backing off can be a project. Okay, there we go. All right, so I can see where my holes are, which means I need to make certain that I reference them relative to the top of the page and I put my paper on correctly. So I'm going to work with this facing me, and I know that this edge I want along this edge of the page. Now I'm not going to try to line this up perfectly because I'm liable to make a mistake. What I'm going to do is come really close and know that I'll come back and do some trimming afterward. As I said, I know I want just this bottom edge of the lace along the bottom of my page, so I'm going to bear that in mind. And I'm actually going to turn this way. I think it's going to be easier for me to see what I'm doing. I'm going to bear that in mind when I come in, and I'm just leaning forward. I want to line this up. Okay. I'm going to lay that on there and press. And now I'm going to do the same thing that I did a minute ago, which is to come in here with my knife. Now what I am going to do is be cautious about not cutting the whole length of this. I want to cut out just what I need to in order to remove this page from the sheet, from the paper pack. And the reason that I do that is because sometimes when you have an oddly shaped piece, like I'm going to be left with some 90 degree corners here, that actually pushes you into decisions about how to go ahead and lay the paper out on subsequent pages. I've done that already. I had a corner similar to this, and I cut a chunk off, and then I just laid another piece of watercolor paper over the top, and it made for a kind of interesting page. And that gave me the opportunity to sort of get creative in a way that I might not have ordinarily. And so again, I'll come in, I'll hit this with my hole punch. I do need to trim along here. But here is the beginnings of a page. And what's left is to now come in with various elements. Lace, rubber stamps, elements, all kinds of fun things. I have some cool moths and bugs from a collage sheet. And all of those elements go into making up a really interesting collage page. I'm going to show you a couple of different ways, other ways rather, to add paper on here. Rather than just using a single sheet like this, we'll go ahead and layer some various elements for an entirely different look. For this page, I'm going to combine a piece of the nesting ground paper and some 90-pound watercolor paper that I've stained and distressed. And before I put this together, let me show you how I achieved this. I have a piece of watercolor paper, and I found that for this project, distress stain and gathered twigs is a color that coordinates really, really well, and so that's what I've used most of the time. It's going to be as simple as just squeezing the bottle to make certain that you have the stain flowing, and then rubbing it all the way across whatever size piece of watercolor paper you're using. Now, it's going to curl a little bit, but that really doesn't make any difference. Want to just get nice even coverage here, and I don't care about the swipe marks, that doesn't bother me. And you have a couple of options. You can use this as is, or you can do what I'm going to do. I have some Perfect Pearls Mist in just the color Perfect Pearl that I'm going to spritz in here, and you can see that it kind of moves the stain, so that gives you some auxiliary patterning. But I'm going to dry this, and then I'm going to show you how you get some really good patterning. So let me come in with my heat gun and just dry this. This piece of watercolor paper is now dry, so what I'm going to do is bring in my bottle of water, and I'm just going to spritz on here, and you'll have to play with your bottle to find out how you get big drops versus how you can get some smaller drops. But you're just going to spritz it on there as much or as little as you like, depending on how much patterning you want, and let it sit for 15 or 20 seconds. Come in with a clean piece of paper towel, and I think this has sat long enough, and just start dabbing. And you'll see what happens is you get, this is essentially like the ghosting technique you've seen me demo that Diane Reevely uses for her Dilutions ink sprays. Very similar process, just using it with distress stains. All right, I'm just gonna give this another quick hit with the heat gun to make sure it's dry, because we're gonna use this in a couple of minutes. I need it to be dry for that. Okay, so now you see how I actually accomplished that. Let's talk about putting this page together now. I've pre-trimmed the bottom of this because I know, and again, I need to see where my holes are. Let's see. I can feel. There they are. They're right here. So this is the top of my page right here. Having said that, I know that I want this piece aligned about like this, and you'll notice that here's one of those cutout pieces we talked about in the last segment. This is a great piece to use even though there's a chunk missing out of it, and I can do all kinds of fun things with it. So having said that, I'm trimmed here. I know that I want this edge, I don't want this little bit that's left here to be on this page. So what I'm going to do is peel off my score tape backing, and I'm going to get this first piece in place. Sometimes no matter how dutifully you burnish this stuff down, it does not want to peel off, and this is a piece that's not wanting to peel off. Okay, I'm going to work facing me now, and so I know that this is the top of my page. I'm going to turn this piece, Again, bearing in mind, I know that I want this not to be on my page, but I want it to be close. I'm going to line up the bottom edge of this piece of paper with the bottom edge of my page. And I'm just going to lay this in place, and I'm actually going to just tear that like that. Now what I've got to do is I have to be careful because I have super sticky going on here. So I'm going to just turn this under like this for now to get it out of the way. Here's a piece of watercolor paper that I distressed just as you saw me do a moment ago. And you know what, let me get this out of here because it's in the way. What I want to do is lay this over the corner of this page, but I like this section of the page or of this piece better, and so I want to line it up like this. And now keeping that in mind, what I'm going to do is before I go ahead and lay this in place, I'm going to trim it to approximately the size that I know that I want it to be. And so what I'm going to do is tear this about like this. And I know that that's going to give me some overlap. Now the edge of this watercolor paper is going to overlap this edge of the nesting grounds paper. And then I'm going to do the same thing for the bottom of that. All right, and I'm just going to gently sort of lay this about where it's going to be. And I can see that that's off just a little bit, so I'm going to trim it off. Now what I'm going to do, before I put this in place, there's no adhesive here because I've covered it with this piece of nesting grounds paper. So I'm going to eyeball this and say, well, all right, it looks like this is going to overlap perhaps a quarter of an inch. So I'm going to come in with some half-inch score tape, and I'm going to lay it in place right along this edge, as close as I can get to the edge without the tape peeping out from the edge of this paper. The reason I'm going to do this is because this is what's going to keep this in place where it overlays the nesting grounds paper. And I've just gone over a little bit right there, but I can fix that later. And I'm going to do the same thing along this edge. Now, it doesn't make any difference if this overlaps the existing score tape. It's just going to be sticky on sticky, and that'll be fine. And when I say the existing score tape, I mean what we've already got on this page. So let me burnish this, peel off the backing. Okay, bring this back in. And now I know I want to align this corner with this corner of the page. I've got sticky on both edges, so I know it's going to stay once I put it in place. And I'm going to lay this again. I'm not going to try to align this perfectly. I'm going to be content with trimming that after the fact. And now, because of the score tape, what I've just done is laid this on here, but this edge is not going to lift up now. After that, it's simply a matter of trimming, and then I have a page, in fact, I have two at this point, that are ready for embellishing. I have one other way that I put paper on pages that I want to show you, and then we will begin to talk about embellishing the pages. The Grunge book comes with 12 pages, which means that you have 24 sides to cover. Between the fact that there's only 10 sheets of paper in the nesting grounds pack, and in the interest of some visual diversity, you need to do something besides use nesting ground papers as the focus of the pages. And so what I've done is I've worked in some dictionary paper, and this is the piece of watercolor paper that you saw me distress with the stain and the Perfect Pearls mists just a few moments ago. What I like to do with this is incorporate the two of them into a page, and where these overlap, where you get this border, you can do one of two things. You can either tear it so you get this kind of rough looking edge the way we did a few minutes ago, or you can cut it straight and then find a way to camouflage the seam, and I'm going to show you how I do that. Dictionary paper, obviously as it comes from the dictionary, is not going to match what we're doing. So I'm using Distress Ink in the color Brushed Corduroy, and I found that the Gathered Twigs was just a little bit too dark for this. I didn't quite like the way that it looked. So all I'm doing is just streaking some of the brushed corduroy on this using a piece of cut and dry foam. You can do this with your blending foam, whatever you have handy works. Doesn't really take a whole heck of a lot. Now again, I've got score tape on my page. I can see that here's where the holes are. So this is the front top of the page as it's aligned to me. My goal is I want to put the dictionary paper here, and then I want to overlap this piece of colored watercolor paper like this. I have a couple of pages right now where the dictionary paper is on the outside edge, and so again, just in the interest of being a little bit diverse, I want to incorporate something just the opposite like this. So I'm going to peel the paper backing off of the score tape. And then the first thing I want to do is align this dictionary paper on the page. Again, it doesn't have to be perfect, but I do want to make sure that it's reasonably straight. I'm just going to lay it on there. And in the same way that I did in the last segment, knowing full well that I'm going to have an overlap and that I want to adhere it, I put some score tape on the back of my watercolor paper. And again, now I'm just going to lay this in place, seeing where I am to make sure I'm straight. Okay, and now that's on. So I'm going to now come in, I'm going to trim this all off, grab my mat, my ruler, and the knife, and then I'll show you one of the things that I can do, that you can do to camouflage that seam. Again, it takes just a minute, and we'll trim all this off. So we're all trimmed up. Again, here are my holes, so the page would actually go like this. The way that I'm going to camouflage this seam is with a piece of 1/4-inch nylon rickrack. And I could glue this in place, but I'd have glue all over my fingers and glue all over the place. So what I'm going to do instead is use 1/8-inch score tape. Again, you all know that I love this stuff. I think it's incredibly handy. And I have all of the sizes here, and I use them all of the time when I'm working. Now, this rickrack is a 1/4 inch wide, and so you're just going to barely get this 1/8-inch score tape right down the very middle between the zigs and the zags so that you camouflage the actual tape behind the rickrack. But it holds it in place for you, and you don't have to mess with a toothpick or some kind of an applicator to get the glue on, and then you put too much, it seeps out behind the edge. It makes you crazy. This is just so simple, comparatively speaking. It does take a moment to get this aligned on here, but once you do, again, I'll just trim that end off. I'm going to burnish this in place. I want to be certain that I have good adhesion so that the score tape holds this rickrack in place. If I could pick it up. Well, really. I'm all thumbs here today. I'll peel that off. And now I have a piece of self-adhesive rickrack. I mean, you couldn't ask for anything easier. I'm going to lay this on here so that I overlap the two seams and I don't actually see either of them this way. I'm going to press this in place, and it's done. Grab my scissors, trim this, and trim this side, and there's the seam all camouflaged. Now, one thing that I like to do, and I would typically do this when I had paper on both sides, but I want to show you now while I'm thinking about it. Actually, you know what? This is the one I was working on previously, and it does have paper on both sides. I like to take the gathered twigs stain, and I'm not going to squish a lot of the stain up into the foam pad. All I want to do is run the edge of this along that foam pad, and it colors the edge of the grunge board, and it kind of makes everything blend together. Now, I'm not getting good coverage right here, so what I'm going to do is just lightly press this on my craft sheet. Again, I don't want too much of the stain puddled in that foam. I want just enough so that I can lightly cover that edge. And you will see that you do get a little bit of creep along the edge here where it does creep in under the paper. I don't mind that at all. If you find that offensive, then you can develop a different way to go ahead and color these edges so that you don't see the gray of the grunge paper. You know, you see this sort of coordinated effort where all of the colors work together. Once you have your pages ready, it's time for the really fun part, and that's going to be the embellishing. Now it's time to gather up all those bits of paper that you've been saving. The pieces from the nesting grounds group, maybe bits of leftover dictionary paper or some watercolor paper. Sometimes just a little piece of paper can add a real bit of interest. This little strip underneath this B, I really like the way that this works. Again, another little strip on this craft envelope just sort of adds a bit of interest. This page has actually got two pieces. This narrow floral strip came from an entirely different piece, as did this section here along the bottom. This is the page that you saw me work on earlier where we put this piece of rickrack on, and what I've done is just laid a piece of leftover strip on here. This is from one of our collage sheets, and I rough cut it out of the sheet, placed it on a piece of score tape, and then cut it out. So now what I have, once I peel that paper off the back, is a self-adhesive sticker for all intents and purposes. This is really super easy. This is a leftover piece, and I managed to smudge some of the gathered twigs stain on here. So what I want to do is cover that up, and let me just turn it around so it's facing me. I've got some score tape on the back of this piece, and all I'm going to do now is align it so that visually I like the placement, put it in place, and it's done that easily. I mean, score tape is just so wonderful. It makes this kind of stuff so easy. Now, these bits of paper are just the beginnings of the kinds of things we can do. We're going to look at some craft envelopes, we're going to look at stamping, we're going to make some little inchies, and all kinds of fun things. Let's start our discussion of possible embellishments with three that I've been using a fair amount. I'm talking about stickers, rubber stamping, and ribbons. Earlier I showed you this page when we were talking about adding bits of leftover pages, and I did mention this briefly, but I did want to point out that you can take almost any element and make it into a sticker and adhere it to your page. So if you have collage elements that you really, you've been accumulating and you really like and you think fit with this project, then go for it. If you have copyright-free images that are yours to use, print them out, put them on your score tape, peel off your backing, and you're good to go. All kinds of variations, all kinds of possible things that you can do, so don't overlook making your own stickers. They're quick, they're easy, and it works really well. Jumping now into ribbon, and you can see that I've taken this fleur-de-lis ribbon and I've put it on the top of this page, and this is very straightforward. I also took some paper that I colored and I stamped this bird head on it. I have three sets of stamps that I'm working with a lot with this. One from Hampton Arts that includes this and three other bird-oriented designs. I have a set of numbers that I'm using a lot, and I'm going to talk to you about these 43s that you see here. This is something that sort of happened by accident, but we'll talk about that in a moment. And then I have a set of stamps that's inches, and I'm going to show you about those in a second. But you can do various things with ribbon. I have this piece aligned up vertically on this page, and again, from that same collage sheet with the B that I just showed you a moment, I cut these elements out, made them into stickers, and this kind of reminded me of those botanical images that you see. And then this page actually uses rubber stamping on this craft envelope. So we're going to talk about all of these things and the fun things that you can do with them. One of the things that I did before I started cutting anything out was I wanted to create some paper that coordinated with the browns that we've been working with. And I've actually been working with three colors. I have the Distress Stain and Gathered Twigs, which you've seen me use. And I've also been using frayed burlap, and you're going to see me use brush corduroy distress ink from an ink pad in a moment. And I just want to quickly show you how I achieved this. And let me grab this. I'm going to need this. I'm not going to dry this, I'm just going to give you an idea of what I did. I'm putting the frayed burlap out on my craft sheet, and as it comes from the bottle, this is probably a little darker than what I want. So what I'm going to do for a little bit of glimmer is I'm going to mist some Perfect Pearls Mist in the color Perfect Pearls in this, and you can see how it really lightens this up, and of course it's going to give it the shimmer. And then all I'm going to do is drag, this is just my normal 90 pound watercolor paper that you see me use all the time. I'm just going to drag this through there, and you can see how you get this variation of color. And you can dry this and then come back and dunk it again if you want. So that's certainly an option as well. And let me just get that out of the way. And obviously I had enough here. You can do multiple pieces like this, and that works out really well. Now, that was what I used to stamp this bird on. So that's something that you can do. And that is another option as well as working with this set of inchy stamps. And let me turn this around this way. This is that same paper, and what I did was I cut it into 1¼ squares. The inches measure, an inch. And so I wanted to leave a little bit of a frame around there. And this is pretty straightforward. Here's a piece of that 1¼ square paper that I just made. And all I'm going to do, and I'm using Timber Brown. I really like the way this color works. Again, I have a fairly limited palette of browns that I'm working with. And I think that the Timber Brown stays on ink, works really well. So here's a finished inchy. And what I would do is the same thing that I've done here. And all of the ribbon is going to be applied the same way. I put a piece of score tape on the back. And all I would do would be to peel the protective backing off. I'm going to place this on here. Oops, stuck to my thumb. And then I'm going to place my inchies on here, you know, at some interval so that I kind of like the spacing and the way that it looks. And I would play with this, oops, that's going the wrong way. I would play with this a little bit till I was satisfied sort of with the placement. And then you get this really cool look, and you can see that again we get this sort of botanical look as they're arranged on that strip. Someplace in here, on this page, you can see that what I did was I arranged these in 2 rows of 3. Again, you can pretty much do anything that you want. It's just a question of playing with them, arranging your pieces, and seeing how they look. Earlier, I mentioned that number 43. Let me find the page that I'm looking for. This is another, I'm going to talk about the 43 in a second. This is another option. I have these really great craft envelopes. And what I did was I came in and I stamped on here, and then I took some of my brushed corduroy ink from the Distress ink pad, and I just lightly gone around the edges and the flap of this envelope. I just want those to stand out a little bit, just to give it a little bit of interest and to make it look a little bit different. Now this ribbon with the fleur-de-lis on it is a little bit wider, so I had to use 2 pieces of score tape, but ultimately I'll just put it on here like this. I'll get this arranged. This was the page that we made earlier. I thought this was kind of blocky looking and like I needed to cover that up. I wasn't real thrilled with the way that it looked. So my solution is to come in and I'm going to do something like this. And I think that this sort of breaks up that page or that blocky area so that I don't find it quite so aggravating to my eye, I guess, is what you could say. On the back of this page is, again, this is something that you saw me work on earlier. Ages ago, when I was first working on this, one of the things that I started to play with was putting some numbers on the pages. It's a book. Oftentimes, pages in a book have numbers on them. But then I got to playing around, and I realized that I kept using the number 43. No idea where that came from, but it was something that I was playing with. And I have this really cool set of stamps that's really intended as to make calendars or something like that, but I've arranged the numbers on here, and I've set them up on this block so that the distance is set, and I know that the numbers are straight. And then I'm just going to come in here, and I'm going to stamp this number 43. And ultimately, all of the pages will have some version of 43 on them, whether I've stamped them with the large rubber stamp like this, or I've taken the small numbers from one of my small alphabet stamps and stamped the 43 in a smaller version. I think this just provides a little bit of continuity and a little bit of cohesion among all of the pages, and I kind of like the way this looks. Now, ribbons, rubber stamps, and stickers are just a little bit of what you can do. We're going to look at some other options in just a moment. One of the benefits of working with the Grunge board books is that the pages are very thick and sturdy, and though they do flex, they hold up really well under weighty elements. Something like this pewter accent B, or this heart, or this leaf, none of these are really going to affect the page in any negative kind of way. You can use things like the Melissa Francis resin embellishments. I have a couple of different ones here. This one was colored, I think, with vintage patinas. I know this one was, and then I came in with just a little bit of glitter to highlight it. This one I colored with Perfect Pearls Mists. I just sprayed a really heavy coat on it, let it dry, and then I touched a little bit of glitter along the body just to give it a little bit of glitz. You can use the ideology numerals, and you see here another manifestation with my current fascination with the number 43. I thought this would be kind of an interesting way to add that number to this particular page. You don't have to work with heavy by any means. If you want to bring in some lighter weight textile elements, you can do that. This is just some cheesecloth. These are actually leaves from our suede leaf trim. The cheesecloth, of course, is stark white like this, but all I did was put a little bit of the distress stain on my craft sheet, mixed in a bunch of water, and you have to experiment a little bit so that you find a color that's not too dark. And if what you dye ends up too dark, just take it to the sink and rinse it out while it's still wet, and you'll lose most of the color that's in there. And then I just kind of arranged it on here and put my elements on top. Now those leaves actually come in a length like this. They're intended as trim, but you can cut them apart. And then you can come in with, this is again brushed corduroy that I have on my cut and dry foam. You've seen me use this at various times. And you can use it to kind of darken these leaves if you want, or you can just leave them this color, whatever really works. Something else that I like is to use Tim's tissue tape. I have a piece here on this page, and you can see that it's a real easy product to work with. You just reel it off the roll, put it in place, press it on, and then you trim it, and you're good to go. There are a multitude of ways to embellish the pages, far more than I'm showing you here, but certainly lots and lots of ways that you can add your own distinct personality to this book. With the pages finished, let's turn our attention to the front and back cover. The Grunge book, as it's packaged, does not come with anything that could be construed as a cover. It's just got those 12 pages with the binder rings that hold it together. And I decided that I did want something other than one of those acting as the back and front cover. So what I've done is I've cut some chipboard pieces. They measure 6 1/4 by 6 1/4. And I've come in with some sandpaper and just lightly sanded the edges to soften that harsh edge that happens when you use a paper cutter on this chipboard. I just like the way this looks and feels a little bit better. After some thinking about it and trying to figure out the best way to put a cover on this book that wouldn't detract from the pages, I decided that simple was better, and I wanted to add some gesso to the cover and then come back in and stain what remained of the chipboard. So what I'm going to do is just dribble some gesso on this chipboard. Now you need to bear in mind that however much gesso you put on here, wherever the gesso is going to resist the distressed stain. So I'm going to just lightly cover some of these areas, and if you want more white, then you need to use more gesso and leave less of the chipboard cover showing. And this is just all I'm really doing, coming in and touching this with my palette knife to kind of spread this out randomly. And I can just dab a little bit in here. And if you decide that you want a little bit of dimension, not that gesso tends to be particularly dimensional, but you can add a little bit, and all I'm going to do is just drop some on the back of my palette knife, and I can come in and I can just lay this down a little bit more thickly in areas if I want to do that. At that point, it's a question of putting it to one side and letting it dry, and let me do that. And then I need to clean the gesso off of my palette knife and close the gesso and make myself a clean area to work here. And again, this is where the nonstick craft sheet really shines because it cleans up so easily. I have this one already prepared. The gesso is dry, and let me show you what you do once you get your gesso dried. Again, I'm coming back with the distress stain in gathered twig, and I'm going to apply this to the chipboard. And you can see that even the gesso is taking the color, or at least appears to be taking the color, but that's actually not the case. You do need to work reasonably quickly, so you're going to come in and just apply this every place. But the gesso acts as a resist, so where the gesso is, the stain will not be. And after much trial and error, I discovered that you have to apply your gesso and then come back and apply the stain. If you do it any other way, what happens is that the gesso activates the stain and then it really discolors. Now, this is never going to be as white as it was initially, but I can come in here with a wet paper towel, not knock over the stain, and remove the stain that's discoloring, if you will, the top layer of the gesso. And you can remove as much or as little of this as you like. If you like the darker look, then go ahead and leave more of that on there. But I really liked, I really liked the way this looked when I took most of the stain off. I liked the contrast between the gesso and the dark color of the stain. Let me just grab a little bit more paper towel. And you can see that this does come back to the almost white color. All right, let me put this to one side. And I have one that's already finished. Because I wanted simple, it became a question of, okay, so here's my cover. What do I want to put on the cover? And I was playing with the nesting ground papers, rearranging them and looking at what I had. And I realized this is the front insert that has all the information about the paper package on it. And I realized that I could carefully tear the words nesting ground off of here, leaving nice ragged edges. And I can do the same thing with this branch and actually use these as elements on my cover. And there's actually a little house on here too that you can take off and utilize if you want. And I'm not going to pull all of this out. I'm just going to take a piece of it off. But you can see what you end up with are these elements. Try to do this a little bit carefully. Are these elements that you can use on your cover, or in fact, if you decide to do something different for your cover, you can go ahead and use them on one of your pages. Now, I haven't actually made up my mind yet about how I want to lay this on here, but I'm thinking about something like this. And let me turn this around so that you can see it. I kind of like the way this looks. It's nice and simple. It tells you what's going on. The colors coordinate with everything else in the book. I haven't done anything to the back yet, but my guess is I'll either come in here maybe with just a piece of dictionary paper and put the whole piece of dictionary paper on the back of what is this inside front cover. The back cover, if I can figure out where I put it, just bear with me one second, I know it's here. The back cover, I used one piece of paper from the Nesting Ground set. There is one that obviously is larger than this, but basically what it looks like is a stage with a curtain partly drawn back. And so I arranged this so that I got most of the curtain on here. And there is a piece up here that I cut off, and when you look at the paper in the Nesting Grounds pack, you'll see what that looks like. But I kind of made a decision about what I thought was important to be on this page. And then I typed this out on my computer with a fancy font and printed it on my printer. And then I came in with my handy-dandy cut-and-dry foam that I had used on the brushed corduroy ink pad, and you've seen me use this in earlier segments. And I just rubbed it on here, and then tore this the same way that you saw me do just a moment ago, and stuck it down on here. And this is how I'm going to leave the back page. And on this one, I just came in and used the distress stain in Gathered Twig to just cover the inside of the back cover and the edges. Once you have your covers done, then you have to think about putting holes in them. And I have my We Are Memory Keepers, this heavy duty punch, which will easily punch through this chipboard. And when I designed these covers in terms of the size, it was always my intent that this edge of the cover would align with this edge of the page, and I would be left with roughly, this is probably about 3/16, a 3/16 border all the way around. I really liked the way that that looked. The next step would be to punch holes in the front and back cover, and then put it all together with the binding rings. And the rings that come with this book, or excuse me, with the Grunge Book kit, are not going to be big enough to handle this. So I'm going to grab some rings from one of the Seven Gypsy binding ring sets, and I'm going to use those. And then ultimately, I'll put this all together, and I'll have a book that I really, really like. I hope you enjoy making your version of this book. It's incredibly gratifying. These are not the normal colors you see me use, but I had a really good time working with something outside of my normal color range, and I hope you have just as much fun when you make art.